What we said prior to this day, just erase it. I will call a meeting to order, it's 6:04 PM. Just for the record, this is a public meeting being video and audio recorded for cable broadcasts and internet posting on www.townofdyton.com. If you wouldn't mind, would you please stand and join me in the pledge allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everybody. Okay, moving along to item number four, public input. We don't have any public tonight, so we'll move along. What I'd like to do is move on to item number 6B. With us tonight, we have our animal control officer who also does the bond permits. And so in case, should she get a call to have to leave us, we'll review, discuss, and act item 6B, bond permit program. Do you know about this?
Well, I know that I had asked for those things to go on the, on doors, I guess back in November, which I didn't realize it was that far away. And now we're re-looking at it now.
Right, Roz and I, we never finished that task.
Okay, well, I wonder why.
Yeah.
With everything that's going
fine.
On.
It's fine.
Yeah, we'll be getting the...
What I want is those things that go on the door.
The hangers?
The hangers that go on the door. And I know it said barn permit, but I was hoping, if we look at them, that it also can have, if I stopped, like today, I stopped at a house on Somerset Ave that had goats, the goats were out. Nobody was home, I put the goats back away, kind of thing, because they came right up to me, woohoo, somebody's here. So I put them away. I would like to be able to hang something on the door, letting them know they need to look over their fence, that kind of stuff. So, you know, I was here for whatever. That way...
Well, I know we were kicking around the idea of a leash law one, if the leash law goes through, that we would need the same kind of tag
right.
for that, so...
Right.
Well, why don't you give us some ideas of what
mm-hmm.
items you want us to list on the notification?
Okay.
You were here because of this, you know... holes in the fence or
right.
inspection of the farm, whatever.
Is this something you put like on a doorknob?
Yes, you put on a doorknob so they, and they're usually brightly colored so they see it. See
and then
it.
Will you take a picture of it?
And I'll take a picture of it, and then if it's something like I was told that your dogs are left, or I came and your dogs were outside, no food, no water, no shade, needs to be corrected in so many, you know, that's, and I go back and make sure that somebody's taking it off the door and that kind of stuff. Usually in town, they're pretty good about getting back to me, but, you know, cards get slipped or fall.
Mm-hmm.
These, you can see.
Yeah. Yeah, you would know what you really want on there, because from your daily experiences,
right.
that's a good point, Tom brought up.
Well, listen, I think we can dovetail it into the leash law
yeah.
when that comes through, because a lot of it's going to be the same. So, we can be one sticker for
yeah,
everything
right.
when
and
the time comes. So.
Right.
Yep.
That's fine.
We'll work
okay.
on it.
We might as well, if nobody minds, nobody objects, move on to inspector's reports, animal control officer.
Well, I went and put goats away today. We had the rabies clinic on Saturday. It was a success. We had a good amount of people there. People registered their dogs. People came and got rabies shots. We had people from out of town that came in and get rabies shots. So we were pretty busy most
okay.
of the time, so that was good. I am putting on the back burner that maybe not this year coming up, maybe next year, or when Bristol Aggie is done with their renovation, that we combine into a rabies clinic slash other clinic, in the fact that you could do a heartworm test, because the kids are going to be learning vet tech stuff, do a heartworm test, do other shots if people want other shots at discounted prices, and that way we can serve more people and more people will be able to do things for their pets because it's so expensive to bring them to the vets.
Well, that's a great idea, so we'll be able to do lab work and
Will be part of their program when they have their expansion. So it will give the students some things to, you know, be able to hold or to draw blood or whatever, and then we'll be able to provide a service to the town at a cheaper cost. And if people don't know, Bristol Aggie on Saturdays has grooming.
I was just gonna ask you that question.
They have grooming. Your dog has to be up to date with its rabies vaccine, but they do have grooming on Saturdays. Sometimes you leave them. If it's a dog that you can't leave, they do have a petition that you can watch through the glass. And they also have a doggy daycare there, if nobody knew.
Every day of the week?
That's every day of the week. That also helps students with that kind of business and that kind of stuff. And a couple times I know they've had a trainer there, but I don't know how that falls. But I do know they have doggy daycare and they do have grooming.
Oh, okay.
I think they do grooming too on Tuesdays, but I'm not quite sure about that.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, something for some people to look into, because I've had a lot of people, you know, where do I take to do this? Granted, if a student is grooming your dog, it may not be as good as the professional groom you go to, but at least they get experience. And they do just dog washes. All you have to do is take your dog in, they wash it, cut its nails, clean its ears, and
nice. That's
it. So, just not that far away.
They don't do the expression, right?
I don't know if they do the anal gland expression. I can do it. I don't announce
I
that.
I know.
But it's not my favorite job. Not anybody's
well,
favorite job,
it smells
I have
so high
to
heaven.
Say. But they may in the future, if they don't do it now, they may in the future. Your groomer should know how to do that, but as a vet tech, you also should know how to do that. So that will be something that they may be able to provide later.
Yeah, it's not the nicest thing in the world to.
No, it's not. There's been a lot of discussion on Facebook about the leash law.
Good.
Yes, it has been good. As I've written, I am in support of a leash law. I never thought 2 or 3 years ago I would say that in this town. But when you have a month of almost 30 bites, whether it's human, dog on human, dog on dog, dog on cat, we need to do something. Something has to be done.
Yep.
And as I've told somebody, if you're a responsible pet owner, this leash law is not going to make any difference in
your
world.
That's correct.
It's those people that aren't responsible pet owners that it's going to make a difference in their world. So if you're the person that walks your dog on a leash in your yard and outside your yard, this is not going to affect you at all.
Correct.
So those people that support it, I really wish they'd come out to the town meeting and support it. There'll probably be a lot of people there because everybody has pros and cons about it. But we need to do something in town.
Yeah, we just got to give them, during the meeting, we got to get the statistics.
That will
so
be
a habit. You know, we didn't just decide to
do
this.
No, because as I said, 2 years ago, I would have never thought I'd be standing behind a leash law in this town. But we've got to do something. I can't have another summer that I had almost 30 houses under quarantine because I had dogs that bit people.
Yeah, and it's you know when you consider the stress that goes on a family, especially when you got a dog bite, and you don't know if the dog status of the dog, and so it's quite a process, and we'll see how it goes. Hopefully, you know, my personal opinion, and we can't do it, is put it on subdivisions because that's where the problems are for the most part.
Right.
So if we're going to do it, it's got to be done
right
for the whole town.
Right.
But I think most people at this point are responsible pet owners. And, you know, it's not going to, like you said, it won't affect anybody. It's not a big deal.
Right.
So. Well, that's up to Fox. I mean, I was thinking about the dog. The dog park down at. That's really not a dog park.
It's not a dog park. The state shut them down.
I thought they would.
Last meeting, I went to Rec's Park and Rec. I'm going to be very honest. I am not in support of a dog park in town for a number of reasons. But I did ask them to go talk to Bristol Aggie because Bristol Aggie's doing their whole big expansion. They, you know, they want to be involved in the community and do that kind of stuff. So somebody did, unfortunately, because of the expansion right now, they don't have the room to put one in. But it's, everybody thinks it's so easy. It's not gonna be an easy thing, and the town's gonna be on the hook for anything.
Yeah, and there's a lot of liability and responsibility, and, you know, you can't just bring your animal down, let it run around, and you have to monitor it, you have to pick up, you know, the waste afterward, and people.
There are places in town that you can walk your dog on leash, and down at the boat ramp, you can let your, as of right now, let your dog loose, and it can play in the water and that kind of stuff, and you can throw the ball in the water and play there. But you can walk on any of the trails, you can walk with a dog on leash, you can walk your dog on leash on Sweet Knowles.
Right.
So it's not like we don't have places that you can walk your dogs. I understand the off-leash thing and the socialization thing, but I don't know, I have a hard time with the dog park per se. So
okay.
if it happens, I'll have to deal with it. But there's a lot of liability with it, a lot of policing with it, because yeah, everybody says they're gonna do one thing, and down the road 6 months, nobody's doing what they said they're gonna do, and
yeah.
who gets stuck with that? The town. So.
Okay.
I know, we don't want town employees going over there just to clean that up.
Well, that, and you know, you're requiring them to have their rabies vaccines to go in there. Well, who's going to sit there and make sure that they all have their rabies vaccines? Who's going to make sure they're licensed in town? Somebody's got to sit there from, say, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. or 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. Who's going to do that? Not me. I don't have the time for that. So, you know, you've got to, there's a lot of things that go into a dog park that people, I don't think, really realize. That's why Rehoboth doesn't have one, Swansea doesn't have one, Somerset doesn't have one, Taunton doesn't have one.
There's a reason why.
There's a reason why. In Taunton, you can go to the bird sanctuary and walk your dog also. So there are places around that you can do that.
Okay. That's good. Thank you. That was a good report. Number one, a new business, 5A. Review, discuss, and act private tobacco funding. Those of us on the Board of Health received notification that the funding for tobacco control officer who does the inspections of our facilities will not be getting funding for the town of Dighton anymore as of, but they will have funding through September of this year. And we don't know where that's going yet. We just received a letter from her telling us that funding has ceased for the town of Dighton and a few other, six other communities, I think. Maybe because of the size of the town, I don't know. But I asked for an estimate of what it would cost for private tobacco funding if she came out here and did what she normally does. As far as the, not the inspection, what do you?
Compliance checks.
Compliance check, yeah.
She has to do the compliance checks, and they also do inspections where you go out to the establishments, you know, you check signs, you check the inventory, you give the copy of the regulations to the establishment owner, you review any of the, go over any of the questions, you go over the regulations, and then later on at some point you do the compliance checks and you actually see if they
That was our two options. I just you don't have a copy of the letter there, do you? That
very well might.
She sent us
tobacco private funding. Sorry, I'm not on the ball.
So you can throw it, that's fine. Okay. Let me see, that one might be different, please.
No, that's something else. That was something else.
No, the one I threw back at you. That.
Yeah, but this was about one case of noncompliance.
Okay. Yeah, I don't have the original letter.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. It was clipped to the back somehow. I think, is that the one you're looking for?
also. Anyway, I don't have the letter, the original memo that she sent us regarding funding, but I do have, after I spoke with her on the phone, what the cost would be for compliance check and inspections. She writes back and tells us, the formula that I use in Bellingham, 28 stores, is $30 per store for compliance checks plus reimbursement for any products purchased. This amount includes paying the youth buyer, purchasing the products, entering the data into the state database, if accessible to me, email notice to the board, and getting the data and products to the Board of Health. The cost of the products will then be reimbursed to me along with the fee. For any inspections that we just discussed a moment ago, the charge is $50 per hour, including travel time and not mileage. Dighton has 7 stores, and would be $30 per store. So, this is once a year, right? Or twice a year?
The inspections once and the compliance once.
Okay, so you only do compliance checks in your town, right?
In Lakeville, it's I hired Ms. Edge to do the compliance checks at $30.
Yeah.
But I do the inspections.
Okay.
I go out for.
Yeah, there you go.
I go out do
my
stuff.
Another job.
But that's reasonable for me. I think that's reasonable.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
For 7 stores, right?
As long as you have a checklist, it's not that bad, right? Of what you're looking for as far
as
inspection goes.
Yeah. We have a form and we go through everything.
Okay. So anyway, I don't know what your pleasure is. My opinion, we should probably bring her on at least to complete the compliance checks. It's only $210 a year. I had built it into the budget. It's not a lot of money.
So it's already in the budget?
Yeah, we beefed up professional and technical a little bit under the inspectors.
Would that cover inspections and compliance, or just compliance, you're saying?
No, just compliance.
Okay.
Depending how things go, maybe we can do inspections in-house like you.
Yeah, and you could actually kind of do a dual way when you're doing a food inspection. Once you stop the food inspection, you say, can you sign whatever it is that you sign the inspection report? Then you say, okay. You put that away and say, all right, let's go, what do you have behind the counter? You know, then you say, you know, e-cigarettes are supposed to be behind or locked. Cigar case is supposed to be closed. Let's look at your signage. Each thing says where each sign is supposed to be.
Right.
Let's just check everything, and then you go through that.
The compliance
You can do that when you're doing a food inspection after. You don't want to do them same time.
Yeah.
You want to finish one and then go on to the next one.
I think the compliance checks are important.
Yeah, definitely. You want to see if your program's working?
Mm-hmm. So what's your pleasure?
I'd make a motion to have Marilyn Edge do the compliance checks at $30 per establishment.
Okay, I'll step down and second the motion. So the motion is made and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The carries. We'll bring on Marilyn Edge for private tobacco funding for compliance checks. The next item was 5B, review, discuss, and act, a vote on a non-compliance health order. This is the one I believe that you had to recuse yourself due to a potential conflict. So I would ask for a motion to table number 5B at this time.
So moved.
I'll step down a second that. So the motion made and seconded to table the vote on issuing a non-compliance health order, item 5B. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That one carries. Next item, review, discuss, and act on a deed restriction for 1792 B. Horton Street.
Okay, I don't know. We haven't had a lot of these. I know at the last meeting we talked about it, that they have separation water table. They need a deed restriction put on their property. This one here,
I believe they're still going through the planning board to create the lots or whatever to separate two buildings on one lot, and they're trying to separate it, but one of the buildings, they want to put a deed restriction on for two bedrooms because that's all that's in the building. So they have provided us the bedroom deed restriction, and it's been notarized and signed, so I need it signed by the local approving authority. Pretty straightforward. If you got less than three bedrooms, you need a bedroom deed restriction. They, in this case here, I think they have the separation water table waiver also, so it,
okay,
it does both, so. Pretty straightforward. We've been tweaking this bedroom deed restriction a little bit and adding things to it and taking things out to get it a little bit smoother, so. But only one member needs to sign it.
Did you see the template that DEP provide?
That is DEP's template, because
okay,
we've seen some other towns and it's just a straight restriction. With DEP's template, it has an ability to modify it. So if they wanna add another bedroom on, like put in a new system, whatever, we can keep the bedroom deed restriction on there on. But some of these towns, it's on there forever, and if you wanted to tear down the house and build a new one,
yeah,
you don't have the ability to do it, so.
I guess on some you can go back to the board.
So it's a little more cumbersome than the simple ones,
yeah,
but it, legally it's what DEP is suggesting, so.
So just a refresher, this one was a separation of groundwater?
No, this is because they want a two bedroom house, and well, and a separation of groundwater,
okay,
so.
Okay.
Is this the property?
It's actually Old Horton. So you're going down
Old
Horton,
Horton,
and Old Horton goes straight ahead and comes back in. And it was a gift shop, I guess, at one point.
Okay.
And there's a house in the gift shop, and again, they're trying to split it. So
there was a gift shop there?
Before my time.
These people are, we have not yet heard, the planning board has not yet heard this.
I am not signing any of their permits for them to do any work until the lots are created. But the bedroom deed restriction, we just won't record it until we're ready to go, but I figured we should get it signed and ready to go.
Should they get approval somewhere down the line?
But once it is two lots, then yes, we can give them two permits, we can record that and everything. Well, if you don't want to sign it now, we can wait and sign it until after the two lots are
created.
Well,
I would prefer to do that because upon legal advice, we've been told that this cannot be done. Cannot split those lots.
Well, then in that case, I would suggest we table this.
Yeah, I think so too. Until we have our meeting, the planning board will be meeting and hearing this next Wednesday about these creation of two lots, one being the former garage that's now a dwelling, and the other dwelling that's on the property.
You're talking legal advice to the planning board.
Yeah, this was legal advice to the planning board at the time. We will be discussing it at our next meeting, and I really would prefer to wait on this until we see what happens with everything.
I'm gonna make a motion to table 5C deed restriction for 1792B Horton Street.
Okay, I'm gonna step down and second the motion. Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That motion carries. So that was motion to table, deed restriction 1792B Horton Street. Did,
yes.
You did, okay.
I've watched enough stuff on TV about the budget.
I haven't. I don't know what's going on with our budget.
Well, here you go.
Okay.
You wanna tell you how sick we are working on this budget? There you go.
I watched the other night.
We don't need that one.
I thought I was like, you're still watching this?
Some of the.
I was like, wait, they're almost done.
No, they're not almost done.
Well, I was just saying what I was watching on TV.
For the most part, the budget is pretty straightforward with contracts for the solid waste budget. Mostly our contracts and they are totally contracts. One with the Covanta for the burning, and then there's a transportation and pickup for trash and recycling. So everything else that wasn't contract, we level funded. So in the other than the salaries for the landfill attendant. And the that's it, because we don't have a part-time clerk. So we increased that by 2% to salaries. The more prominent ones that are gonna require discussion with the FinCom is on page one, animal control officer. And the number you see, 16,179,04.
Yep.
It changed that to 17,522,40.
17,524,40.
522,40.
Sorry, I noticed another mistake on the bottom.
We're going back to where we were before. 2% of last year's budget plus 2,500. That should bring you up to 17,522,40.
And that's for which line item? The salary animal control officer?
Yep.
Yep.
I don't know if this makes a difference, but Board of Selectmen voted to raise that to 20,000.
Really?
Yes, they did.
Well, that's pretty darn good.
I can tell you exactly what they decided to raise it to. Yep, 20,000.
Now that's gonna be their recommendation.
Right. We agreed last night to raise your salary to 20,000.
You know what the town administrator recommended?
Recommended the same thing. She was okay with 20,000.
I like that number.
I do too.
Okay, let's bring it to 20,000. How did they arrive at that? Any idea?
I do, because I was in a meeting and they were talking about salaries, and the chairman said, I want a study done to see where she falls. And he sent me something saying the average ACO is $41,000 a year. That's the average salary. Some more, some less.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't have definite hours, most, you know, some do, they all arrived at 20,000.
Because when they asked me, when I go to talk to them, I said, well, that was the recommendation. And the now, did they give you a copy of the survey that they did of surrounding towns, or should I get that from Mallory?
Mallory probably has.
Okay. All right. So that's good. The next item is salary for the assistant ACOs.
And I know they cut that back down to 22. That's just their recommendation.
Did they leave that at 44?
No, they cut that to 2,200.
Back to what it was.
Yeah,
back to
I think
it was.
I heard that on the...
Yeah. But that's their recommendation, so that's up to you.
That's where the difference came from. Yeah.
From 17 at 2,200 to it, you're up to 19,500, so yeah.
Well, you were right, it will be an interesting discussion. See, here was, when this was developed, my thoughts, and as discussion with Todd as we went through this, we would like to get two, and that would give you weekends and evenings off. But I wonder at 2,200, I'm not sure because I still want to run with 4,400 for two people. That would take away, that would fund one person, 2,200. So believe that we'd probably have to consider you working alternating weekends with somebody like Del. I wonder if Del would be interested in coming back if he knew he didn't have to be available every weekend.
I don't know.
But that's the reason he left.
Yeah, I don't know.
All right. So anyway, that's where we're at with that.
It's a tough position, I feel.
Hmm? It is, because you're asking somebody to stay in town all weekend. and, you know, if you work during the week or whatever.
Do they get, what was it, do they get on-call money?
Well, it was, they were just, it was just like a salary stipend for the weekend.
Okay.
I mean, you could do it that, put on part-timers and the only time they get paid is when you, when they have a call, you could do that.
What happens on vacation this year?
Well, last week.
Police?
Police, if, well, there was anything big, the police would take it, I handled all telephone calls while I was away.
Maybe someday you'll actually leave the country, then we'll.
Just for the record, so one of our arguments. In fiscal year 13, she was actually making more money than she was at this point. Until it was decided by some people to take it away from her, so. Okay, moving on. All these other lines, I believe, in the ACO budget were level funded, as you can see, so 0% increase.
Equipment and maintenance was decreased, no?
It was. But we added in a line item D1 that looked down towards the bottom, says division by zero, because we added in a separate line item for additional equipment.
Okay.
Because that line item there was building repairs and maintenance, so she could only maintain her current equipment, she couldn't buy new equipment. So we wanted to take and give her an ability to buy new equipment.
Makes sense.
Yes, there's no catch poles or whatever,
yeah,
she
and didn't we
nets.
Just didn't we just buy some stuff?
So
put in the order.
And we can't expect the department to be efficient and run.
Oh, and the, I'm sorry, and the building repairs and maintenance, because the other one was equipment repairs and maintenance. So we added in a line item for building repairs and one for new equipment. So, so that's why that number jumped around.
Okay, moving on to.
That's the easy part of the budget.
Yeah. 510, Board of Health Regulations and Inspection, Salary, Animal Inspector. This has been changed a few times. I believe, unless things have changed with the meeting, we're at 2%, 1033.78.
Yeah.
Is that what they agreed to?
I didn't see that part of the meeting. They just, they didn't really take that part and take it apart.
Okay.
They just approved everything in.
Okay. I think they took some of the money we figured down here and moved it up into the 20,000. That's kind of what it's looking like to me, but if we can agree on a bottom line, that's fine. So they, instead of 35.13.52, it's 10.33.78.
Which must be the 2% increase?
Yes, yeah, straight, just 2%. Salary health agent is increased. We are requesting an increase in salary from $25 to $35 an hour. Clerk agent zeroed out, let's see.
What happens with the, I know we try to do more things in-house, but like Joe Cavallo and everything, how's he?
He would be paid out of the same line if we used him.
Okay.
Because it health agents.
Okay. It's per hour.
Yeah. But Joe gets $41 an hour. So, over in Swansea.
But here he gets 35, right?
Clerk agent has been zeroed out from previous years. Food inspector, same way our health agent does that.
Well, and the members. That's not just me doing the food inspections.
Yeah, I just wonder why we why did we zero out our overtime and additional hours?
Oh, because that's for me.
Oh, okay, yeah, you won't be using it.
Right, so I'm not gonna be getting.
It's down here in the salary Board of Health Administration.
Right, that's right.
Yeah, all right.
Are we still based on 25 hours, right?
Yeah.
Yes. We had gone down to, I think, one of these professional technical lines includes the amount of money for I'll get it in a minute. Marilyn. I'm at
Is she like a private contractor? No. Professional technical?
Yeah, it might be down here.
Those two professional technicals.
Yeah, we had reduced it, then we kicked it up again, but actually this line here.
Professional technical over here, huh?
Yeah.
Well, that was for plan reviews on the 5300 line.
So it's zero now?
And then the they're both 70-5300, aren't they?
Mm.
That's weird that they're in both places, because one of them was for the plan reviews and the other one was for, like, I thought, like, legal assistance or that kind of stuff. So, but it's funny that the same line item, same.
Anyway, there's sufficient money there, and we have decreased the budget.
So what happens on that one? Do you get? You're the same number.
Oh, they're not. I'm sorry. One is 510 is the.
Oh yeah.
Office, and then 519
so
is
which,
the
which is which then? One is
the top one, 510 is for plan reviews, is where that money was going.
But we don't need that, right?
Right. That $12,000 we spent last year, now I'm doing the plan reviews.
Okay.
Yeah, see.
But I think we left $1,000 in there in case I needed a.
So maybe on that one, like you said, maybe for a. Well, you can review things over 10,000 gallons, right?
Yeah, I can review anything. Yeah.
Yeah, there was 16,000.
I have a PE, so I have no limitations on what I can review.
So maybe only on something that would be a conflict, maybe. If that was the case, that's just set aside in case,
mm-hmm.
for like a.
Yep.
Like a town project, we wanted to get somebody else involved. Oh.
Yep.
We could say, it's better off to have it subbed out.
Generally, you would have to pay prevailing wage for anybody that any town project, so.
Like a review, plan review.
Yeah, I mean, it would be nice, but not for us $25 an hour, which is well below what somebody with his ability should be making, so. All right, moving on to Board of Health Administration. Salaries, I think. Chairman and members, we went up 2%. Town nurse, let me say something about these budgets here while I'm thinking, it's on my mind. When I started here in 2006, all the health agents and inspectors were at $20-$25 an hour.
Yep. I started that in 2007, $25 an hour.
That was the first year, 2005 actually was the first year of the clerical contract. And they did not get a percent of a wage increase until 2006. We've done a amortization chart of each year, successive year of the contract, whether it be 3%, 2.5%, 2%. And we've come to the fact it's very close to $35 an hour for these people who had been inspectors. So this is why we chose to, I think, as a matter of fact, and I don't have any evidence of that other than word of mouth, is Joe Pacheco was getting $25 an hour when he was clerk agent here in 2000. So it's been nearly 20 years.
Yeah, I mine was from 2007 until
just last year. You were at 25, right?
I was in 25 for 10 years.
Yeah, so they've fallen through the cracks, and today we're starting to enjoy the 2% or 3% a year, whatever it is, for the government contract, and these positions were kind of left behind, so I think it's only right that we attempt to bring them up to where they need to be. So.
I know, like for Beth.
Yeah, $10 an hour and 25 to 35.
And that makes sense because.
Well, she's per diem, but.
Yeah, per diem, but she does the work.
Yeah.
And how long has she been in?
I don't know any registered nurse that makes $25 an hour, but.
How long has she been in?
I don't know, 4 or 5 years, if not more. Okay, the office manager that went up, that was a negotiated, we're asking for 5 additional hours for office manager. Cause if you recall, when we went through this as members of the, Board of Health Committee, that the committee recommended 35 hours of a clerical worker, and what the Board of Selectmen agreed to was a mixed position of 35 hours, our discretion of how we wanted to do that. So at the time we hired the health agent through existing funds, and our clerical worker was kept at 30 hours, and we think it should be 35 as was recommended by the study committee for the Board of Health. So, and that's at a grade 6. So that's the reason for the increase that you see.
And as the agent, I would say, yes, please get her more hours. We can't keep up with what
we have
now.
I know. And
like I left the office on Monday.
I can argue it here, but you know, maybe somebody will watch and care. But since we split the Board of Health from the Board of Selectmen, we've taken on stormwater and
emergency preparedness. More
the emergency preparedness merged with the disaster committee.
Trash
and
recycling reporting.
What's that?
The retract, the recycling and trash
reporting.
Yeah,
we had
now we're looking to do more
solid
grants.
Waste. So there's been a lot of things that were added that this Board of Health does that some other communities don't. I know the stormwater is a lot of communities, ConCon does it. Don't get me wrong, you know, none of us mind doing what we're doing. But I think if we're gonna do it, we should, you know, at least get the number of hours required and the salary required.
Well, can I just say that you say stormwater is done by conservations or whatever, but most of those other towns are subcontracting it out for somebody to do their stuff. The fact that I'm a professional engineer, I can do reviews in-house without having to send it out to, so.
I hope they buy that.
I do too.
So this is probably the only one we haven't seen on TV yet, right? You haven't gone over this one?
We're not.
We're up next Tuesday.
Okay. Because I've seen.
And if you're not doing anything next Tuesday, it'd be nice if we all could show up.
And that's.
And argue our case. 7 o'clock, I believe, but I'll send out.
I heard that.
If you post it as it's all there, but I'll try. Because the post it there, yeah, right?
If we
could,
just in case, yeah.
Yeah,
just remind me of the. I'll write it down. 7 o'clock.
I believe it's 7. Yeah,
and that is on May 1st.
Second.
Yeah.
First.
I'll send out an email to everyone reminding, please try to be there, because I'll probably forget a few things that I need to discuss. And I believe everything else might have been cut or level funded.
Mm-hmm. Communications, what's that one?
170, 500, 400, 400. Yeah, we cut that back, it's not getting spent.
Well, I will bring up at this point about a phone, that I don't have a phone to the office, so I don't know how that works, if there's like reimbursement for me using my phone and stuff, but.
And we should get you a contract also.
We should just get a phone, well.
Well, we could get a phone, we can talk about that another day, I know we've kicked it around and, you know, right now everything's running okay and I'm not, but it needs to happen at some point, so.
Yeah, especially if you're on any of the call downs, Joe's.
We're gonna be.
I'm on all of them.
Yeah, but I mean like the contact person for, even when we have the mosquito, or we have anything, we have specific people that are.
Wait, if the fire chief calls me in the middle of the night for something, yes, I would rather have my board of health phone on and my personal phone off, so.
Pest control, what's this one? It says pest control.
Right.
Fourth one from.
Oh, pest control.
5380.
Yeah.
That line was.
But what was that for?
Okay. That line was put in, I don't know, 10 years ago for pest control, cause that, one time, few years back, there was a hornet's nest in the tree over by the playground, wasp, and it was pretty bad, pretty big, and there was no line.
How to get rid of it.
For us to pay us out of, so now we have pest control line. So since that date, we haven't had any more nests or problems, so that's what pest control's about.
Okay, I was just wondering.
We do have somebody that is pest control, whatever you wanna call, officer. That's my husband, that's the only reason I know.
So.
But that could be like buildings and maintenance and stuff and.
Right, I mean,
Take care of our ground.
I've called them out for bees nests somewhere.
We have some stuff to take care of our grounds and stuff. Alright, I just was wondering, I didn't even saw that.
It was fun doing the budget, right?
Not the, you know, the first two or three times it was, but the last 12, it wasn't as much fun.
Yeah.
Nothing for travel and reimbursement? A request, 500.
Yeah, that's a little bit of money.
Yeah, good, 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 because you do have, I'm sorry, I read it wrong, because you do sometimes, instead of taking the town vehicle, you might have times be traveling and you need mileage.
Yeah, it's mostly out of town stuff.
Yes.
Yeah.
But that's why we didn't go up or down with it, cause I am using the vehicle we're sharing with the building department, and I'm doing most of my inspections in.
There are some trainings where you.
There are, but in general, that's enough money to cover it, so.
I've got the trainings on the weekends where I take my own vehicle. Cause I'm not gonna go back and forth and bring it back, so.
Yep.
You get mileage, yeah? Okay, good.
So you.
Does this need a motion?
Yes, it does.
I'll make a.
It's kind of a formality.
I'll make a motion to approve the budget as submitted, except for that one change for.
Yeah, as discussed.
As discussed.
Yeah, okay.
Well, if I may, before you, like, you already started the motion, but there was a mistake in the numbers. If you go down to the subtotal down at the very bottom, like at the very bottom of the page, you get the 23,779.
Yep.
That number should actually be 21,299.
21,299?
Yeah,
Wasn't it the Excel?
Cause what happened is we added in an extra $3,000, I think, in there for the computer access fee, and it didn't, the formula didn't change, so the line above that, instead of 7,700, should be 10,783.
Okay.
And the one above that should be 400 to the positive, it actually went up by 400, but the percentages over on the right, the 5.41 and 17.6 stayed the same, so.
Alright, I guess you have the real copy there.
I've actually changed it while we were doing this, so if I had a cable, I could print it out, but.
Well, I'm gonna step down and second the motion, so the motion made and seconded. I think we've had a lot of discussions, so we'll vote, all in favor of approving the budget as discussed and presented?
Aye.
Aye, all opposed, the motion carries. We're gonna move down to 6A.
Let's see if I can put this up.
Single stream recycling contract. We did receive something back from Care regarding the proposed contract. You read it?
I have it in front of me, yeah.
And we have, I think, as a result of the contract as presented, we have some more homework to do. In discussion with our hauler. And since Mr. Tanis isn't here tonight, I feel that we should table this for now.
I'll make a motion that we table.
Motion to table, okay. I'll step down, second motion. Motion being seconded, any further discussion?
Just one quick thing on so the discussion. Are you gonna talk to Mr. Borges regarding?
Yeah, did you get the last what? It looks like.
It looks like we're gonna have, if we went with them, we'd have a gap in when they moved.
Yeah, I mean, and I don't know how many months that would be.
The gentleman told me 1 to 2 months. Is that the email?
Yeah, well, it says, Kevin, please see proposed contract attached. We would need to adjust the starting date for our 1 year contract. Please take into consideration the fact that we are looking into possibly moving our facility to a larger space within Taunton in the next year. And if this were to happen, it could cause us to be closed for a few months while our equipment was removed and reinstalled on a different site nearby. Now, I just got this today. Well, the biggest question I have at this point, if they're going to be closing, we have no place to dispose of our recycles once we leave New Bedford Waste. Are they going to be willing to take us back?
Yeah, that same concerns, because twofold, you have those 2 months, hopefully it wouldn't last long, and then you have the 1 year contract. So you're jumping into a contract where it's really 10 months. And then you have to kind of go back to the other one and have somebody on the side saying, all right, will you, that's why we've got to talk to Peter.
I feel like we need to wait until, number one, they're in their new facility, if it's going to happen, or we'll know further down the road. Or I understood just late today that New Bedford Waste is also planning on going into another facility.
In Rochester, I believe.
In Rochester, and they'll also burn the trash. So, besides taking the recycles. So, I wasn't able to speak with Peter Borges today. I called him back. But he'd be more than happy to come to a meeting and talk to us going forward, and I think we need to do that. Get our hauler in here and see what's what.
That would be good if we had him for the next meeting. Just to kind of iron this out, saying we're looking to, first we're going to have a review of the whole contract and town council and all and everyone, I feel. But then we have an understanding where, all right, this is going here, but in different times, because they said they've done this already, where they had downtime and other communities have sent it out. We just want to have an understanding where this can be hauled off site in different areas. I want that reassurance.
Well, now under the circumstances where we're at, is as far as nobody wanted to take any more, it's probably not that simple anymore.
Yeah.
To just bring it somewhere else and they'll take it. Because how many places did you try to contact?
Yeah, I contacted a few, but they were a little farther away, Avon and stuff. So that was going to hurt.
But
Peter.
Most
that
weren't
was gonna be too
taking
far
any additional.
Yeah.
Recycles.
Yeah, they weren't really looking for new customers.
So, I think we need to sit on this for a bit. And as you just tabled the motion, so we'll get Peter in here next meeting and we'll see. Something you want to add?
No, he said the motion was made and seconded, so.
Yeah, so
now we have to vote, yeah.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Table the motion? I mean,
so you want
table on the item?
Okay, you want us to get Peter in for the next meeting?
Yeah. All opposed? And that motion carries to table item 6A, single stream recycling contract. We need to get some more information on that. You do a good job as And the job description.
Roz owes me. No, I don't believe it is. But thanks for asking. There it is. Alright, so you're doing payroll and bills paid?
Yeah, you wanna just do it instead of passing things on.
Yep, so for the week ending April. Well, cause like we haven't done this in a while, I guess. She's got April 14th, payroll was $1,800, April 21st was $1,600.
Yeah, I think we missed one.
April 30th was $1,300 for animal control and $1,200 for the board, so a total payroll of $6,000 for April, the month of April, I guess. And then bills, we have, we had someone go down and pick up, what was it?
Dog food?
No, the $600 to drive down to New Jersey.
Oh, to pick up my backup, my vehicle.
And.
The unit, the box.
The box.
Yep, so that was $600, we had some constable services and Verizon National Grid bills for a total of $185. We had some stormwater costs for the flyers we handed out at the Steam Expo, which I'll talk about on stormwater. And some other stuff for $365.
Okay.
That was it?
Thank you, Todd. Need to add that to your job description. Alright, as far as subcommittee updates, I was gonna suggest that we wait on stormwater till after tomorrow morning's meeting, but if you have something you want.
I do.
Okay.
Alright, so, yeah, stormwater, we had the Steam Expo, I don't remember the, that was, did we already talk about that at the last meeting? That was April 7th.
At Crystal Aggie?
So we, maybe we already talked about it, yeah, it was, no, it was at Dyton Hobbit.
Right.
Oh.
And we had pamphlets made up and bags, and we had some handouts and stuff, so it was some pretty neat stuff. They handed out a bunch of it. I wasn't there. Nancy Goulart was there representing us, and were you there too?
My anniversary.
Oh, and Tom Ferry was there also. So I guess the item was a success. We still have a bunch more stuff if anybody wants anything stormwater related. So that was that. So that was one of the bills here we had, and I want a big shout out to Bristol Plymouth. We gave them a concept, and they prepared the entire brochure in color and printed the entire thing for us, and the price was phenomenal. And again, it was free labor, and they did a great job with it. So I want to give them a shout out. So stormwater, the MS4 permit is due on Tuesday, May 1st. I have the entire report done. We have the stormwater committee meeting tomorrow morning, so I'm going to be presenting it to the committee for anybody's, if anybody wants to tweak any, the way we worded stuff. But a lot of it is copied from the year before because a lot of it stays the same. But that'll be in by, should be by Monday. So we're, and that's that. That's it for stormwater.
Marriage preparedness. First Wednesday of next month coming up, we have our management meeting, and we'll be moving right on to the emergency preparedness meeting shortly after that. And we hope to reorganize or organize, since it's a brand new committee that has merged. Emergency preparedness before was dealing with only the emergency dispensing site at the middle school. And we have since merged with the disaster committee and so-called the Emergency Preparedness Committee. But now we deal with all acts of gods and other man-made disasters, and any type of illnesses, the whole gamut of public safety. So that'll be right after the next meeting, and we'll be able to generate a full report after that. I know we have a pretty big agenda for that, so.
Yeah, that meeting is May 3rd.
May 3rd?
May 3rd.
Okay.
And yes, Roz and I have been filling up the agenda with lots of stuff.
Okay.
It's during the day though.
11 o'clock in the morning, yeah.
You have anything to report as far as?
No, other than we We gotta go over and count the cots so we can see what we got for cots, because I believe there's we need more, and we gotta see how many we have, so we can maybe buy some more before the end of the year.
Today I.
My vests?
There already are some in there, but we might need some more. This is part of why we need the committee, so we can go down these lists and say, what do we need, what do we have? Like, for example, there's a flat tire on the trailer, we gotta get that repaired, so.
Today I put it in a special article, since it was the last day, for articles to be submitted. It was a request of $5,000 to transfer from key free cash for the purchase of restocking with the sheltering materials, items that we need, such as cots and whatever else we may need. So, the average price I found on cots, and we, last time I talked to the fire chief, we figured 100 cots might be sufficient. You know, they run from $20 to $80 or whatever, and, but it looked like we were discussing a $40 one, so, you know, whatever, whatever we think we need as a committee, hopefully the funds will be there from town meeting. And, 'cause we can't run a sheltering facility without sheltering supplies, so it's.
And these are all unfunded mandates, so.
Yeah, so.
You have to have it, but.
Yeah, and the other thing we're gonna do with that committee is that's the first meeting, so we gotta discuss how often we're gonna meet and that kinda stuff, so, yep.
Do you have some of the ICS in NIMS, right?
Did I take it?
Yeah, okay. So how about you, do you have, okay, so.
I have extra ones too.
I think we're gonna end up being the responsible party for enforcing the training on NIMS and ICS also, making sure that these people are, well, we can't force them.
Yeah, so for those at home watching, ICS is Incident Command Structure, so if there's an event, everybody who shows up to work that event has to know the chain of command and who to work for. So, that, and what the committee needs, one of the items on there is to discuss, does everybody who works in town hall and DPW, all town employees, they should have this training, so they know they don't just show up and go, hey, I'm the town administrator, so I'm in charge. It's like, no, no, you have to fit in the chart where you belong.
Yeah.
And so, if we want everybody to have the training, it's an online free training, and, so we would have to make sure everybody's got it, new employees get it, that kinda thing, so that's one of the items of discussion.
Very good.
Most of this, so, yeah, it's a pretty big agenda, and, I don't know, disaster committee has not met since Selectman Menges left, and we brought it back to life. Last year was the town administrator, I think, that moved the project, and moved that forward, and, we've narrowed the committee from 19 people originally down to 7 people. And what we decided is, everybody has an input, but the basic decisions will be made by 7 people. If we need information and input from our animal control officer, we would invite her into our meeting and bring us up to date on any changes in the law, what's required, with your animals for sheltering. I know at this point you have to bring your cats and dogs,
Any animal.
Any animal.
Yeah, leave your horse, I don't know, we'll have to find a place for horses and.
Well, as we say in most meetings, your large animal owners already have a plan.
Yeah.
They know where their large animals are gonna go.
Yeah.
They don't wanna leave it up to anybody else, they already have a plan if they know that something's coming.
It's the pets at home that they don't wanna leave, they stay home with them.
Right, it's the pets at home. And you can't leave your pets at home, do not leave your pets at home. They have to come with you if you come, we'll figure it out on that end, but they have to come with you. And I always suggest, make sure you have a, just like you pack a bag if you need to, you know, for an emergency, pack a bag for your animal.
Yeah, whatever they have.
Have their dog food in it, have their, if they like certain bowls, if they have medication, make sure you bring that kinda stuff, because it's gonna be upsetting enough, you don't wanna feed them different food and not have their medication and have a problem, so.
And you're responsible for the ammo too while you're there.
They are responsible. We have talked about where we would set them up and everything, but and any animal, that means if somebody has a snake, they have to bring it with them. It will have to stay somewhere far away from me, but it has to come.
Yeah, that's true.
So.
Okay. Your report.
So we've covered a lot of what I have. I will say I left here Monday, no, sorry, Tuesday morning. I worked till 10 o'clock and left. My inbox was empty. I came back in this morning and Roz had filled it up because there's been that many applications coming in, between perks, construction repairs, you know, for the septic systems and Title V inspections. I had a desk full of them, so. Unfortunately, I can't get to them as soon as they come in because we've had the MS4 permits and other stuff that are a little bit more pressing. So I try to get to one or two a day so that we can kind of keep things moving along.
And you just do like everybody else does. You stamp it in when received and just go in that order.
Yep. So
and if you plug away in that order, then you should be fine.
Yep. So, but we're keeping the office moving. We're still settling in with the new files and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
The other thing that we did, Roz and I, the calendar, which we sent out to the board members to look at. So we've started a Microsoft Outlook calendar for the Board of Health. So Roz and I can both add things to it. Like for now, we just talked about the FinCom meeting, so I put it in the calendar. And so once a month, we'll be able to email it out to all the board members or town administrator, selectmen, anybody that wants it, and we can say, here's the upcoming calendar of what we've got scheduled. Now the stuff that's scheduled is perk tests, the MS4 permit is due, department head meeting, emergency preparedness meeting, that kind of stuff. It's not. I went out to Waterford Village to do an open hole inspection.
Yeah,
not that stuff.
It's like a snapshot.
Yeah. It's what, so if somebody's looking for me, like if you guys want to talk to me, say, hey, oh, look, he's going to be on a perk test on County Street.
Yeah.
So, you know.
And in between then, you know, you always have little fillers.
Yep.
There's a lot of things that people come your way, try to get your attention, and you have other inspections.
But this is more for, like say, for the board to know where we're at, or when Roz is on vacation, or I'm on vacation, you know, that kind of. So we're starting that, and you know, any comments you got on anything you want to see on it, but that's, we figure a better way to track the office than us writing it on the calendar on the wall. So, and then Roz and I can access this remotely to edit it. So,
it's good.
It is good. We're moving in the right direction. So.
A lot of work. It's I got a comment because when I was chairman of the Board of Health and Selectmen at the same time. You basically had time to scratch the surface of the Board of Health and do the minimum required to meet state standards and stuff.
Yep.
But now that we have the time and we're moving forward, we see some of the things that should have been done that weren't done, and that's nobody's fault, but we just didn't have the time or the budgets, and so hopefully Dighton's coming into the, what are we at? 20th century. Maybe 21st.
Yeah, 21st. We're getting there very, very rapidly.
So.
But I do spend a lot of my time doing stuff that I wasn't expecting to be doing when I was hired back in August. So. But.
Yeah. And we appreciate it. Let me tell you.
You do a good job.
Okay.
So I have two things.
Go ahead.
One is, I think we should try to work on workshops again. I know we're very busy, all of us, but try to get those regs.
Yeah. Once this MS4 is out of the way, I think you'll have more time to
work. Between that drill that we had to run because the state mandated for the EDS, the retrack certification, and now the MS4, after that, it looks like that's the next item on the agenda.
Okay. Just so, because, you know, you're getting all these plans, and if we have, with the perks, if we move that, we get everything that we kind of went through with our regulations that we want, the cesspools and all that stuff, get that finalized, get that public hearings, hopefully approves what we wanted to approve, and send it off to be published and through the DEP. So this way that part of it's done.
Yep.
There's no coming for a variance, is this or not. So.
Yeah, and like I said, it's the next big item on our list. We've banged out the rest of them.
And the other one I had was, I was looking, Kathy Mirza emailed me from DEP about the IQ kit. And she she's just asking what our thoughts were.
Oh yeah, we have correspondence on that, right?
Yeah, I sent it to you.
Oh, that's the one Raj showed me today.
Yeah. So she's actually talking about extending the, well, she actually said it.
We got a copy of it.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, it's from Kathy Mirzer regarding the recycling. Excuse me, I could quit. I wanted to circle back to you regarding Dunn's interest in applying for the recycling IQ kit. I'm glad I had the opportunity to speak at your Board of Health meeting on April 11th. If the town is interested in pursuing this grant, please let me know. DEP officials advise that it's okay if you choose to apply for this after the deadline of April 30th. Up to a few weeks is okay. They can say April 30th is 5 days away.
I know.
As long as the initiative is completed before Thanksgiving. So, that's a tough timeline to do all that by Thanksgiving.
And we still haven't talked to Peter yet, and
yeah, so.
And like we had talked about, this is.
Well, this is one of the things we can talk about Peter when he comes in next week. Is that assistance with that? And, you know, and when I think about it. They take a peek in it. They see something that doesn't belong there. Throw a flyer on top of it.
I know they could do some of the work.
Well, I think also.
Or even ourselves, if we wanted to do it ourselves.
And I think in the beginning stages, I think some of it can be maybe just some simple signage, maybe on the town website, maybe on the local
channel.
Which
you had given us.
Very, very simple. No peanut butter jars. You know, no mayonnaise jars. They have to be clean. You know, no
plastic bags.
Plastic bags, the big one. And I think a lot of people just don't know. And
because we could probably do it in-house first, then try to apply for the grant at a later time. I don't know. That's the. I guess after we talk to Peter.
Yeah.
It's tough because, like she said, it's not an easy job. It's going to be time consuming. And it's like all hands on deck on this. That's why when she emailed me, I was like, oh, let me bring it up because she's asking. I know there's deadlines, but it's really something you have to either just do it 100%.
And I agree with all that, and it's just the time and
yeah, I know.
We're seem to be behind all the time, but to comment on it was I was speaking to a town administrator about it, and she says, I find myself now cleaning out jars before I put them in the recycling container, you know, which she said she really never did before in her community. And so it's a matter of education and getting the word out on what to do to help us lower the cost of the recycling items.
And that's the key. If you tell people it's the cost thing, that'll get their attention.
Yeah.
So
even that flyer she gave us that we put on the town TV,
mm-hmm.
Our website, everything. So I guess we could start there, but I just wanted to bring it up.
That's fine. There is one thing I wanted to bring out, and we haven't done any food recalls in a while. Some pertain to this area, some don't, but this one is seems to be a hot one at this time. And so I'll read it to you. Information collected to date indicates that romaine lettuce from the Yuma, Arizona growing region could be contaminated with E. coli and could make people sick. The investigation has not identified a common grower, supplier, distributor, or brand of romaine lettuce. Advice to consumers, do not eat or buy romaine lettuce unless you can confirm it is not from the Yuma, Arizona growing regions. Product labels often do not identify growing regions. So do not eat or buy romaine lettuce if you do not know where it was grown. This advice includes whole heads and hearts of romaine, chopped romaine, and salad mixes containing romaine lettuce. If you do not know if the lettuce in a salad mix is romaine, do not eat it. Advice to restaurants and retailers. Do not serve or sell any romaine lettuce from the Yuma, Arizona growing region. This includes whole heads and hearts of romaine, chopped romaine, salads, so forth, so on. Restaurants and retailers should ask their suppliers about the source of romaine lettuce. 84 people so far have been infected with the outbreak of E. coli and has been reported in 19 states. 42 people have been hospitalized, including 9 people who have developed a type of kidney failure called hemolytic uremic syndrome. No deaths have been reported. This investigation is ongoing, and CDC, Center for Disease Control, will provide updates when more information is available. So take what you will from that, but don't eat romaine lettuce. It's so.
Okay.
Anything
one,
else?
Yeah, we have one more announcement. Do you want to read it? Want me to do it?
You want to read it? Go ahead.
Okay. Dighton will be conducting the bulky item curbside pickup during the week of June 11th. So it's like the 11th to the 14th.
Yeah, the whole week.
The whole week. They will be following the same schedule as trash pickup. Bulky items must be out no later than 7 a.m. on those days. The following items may be placed for curbside pickup and disposal: televisions, microwaves, refrigerators, mattresses, washers, stoves, desks, barbecue grill, car tire, lawnmower, computer monitors, air conditioners, box springs, dryers, water heater, file cabinet, propane tank, truck tire. The Freon must be removed from air conditioners and refrigerator doors must be removed. Tags may be purchased at the Selectman's office in Town Hall. A separate tag is required for each item that is to be disposed. Be sure to affix a tag to each item intended for disposal. There's a different fee with each item. That'll be posted on the town website, and we'll put it on the Board of Health website so everybody can see it.
That's good.
Thank you.
That's all.
Anything else?
I have this. I don't have anything.
Good work, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there any motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Step down a second. Motion to adjourn has been made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you, Cable. Thank you, everybody.
You have your romaine lettuce.